Mai mai e tamaki a mihi atu au I hara mai rā koe I te kunenga mai o te tangata I roto e te ahuru mauai. Ka taka te pai o huaki pauri ko te whare hangahanga tēnā tāne nui a rangi I te kune o nei kura waka. Nau mai, hara mai ki tēnei hui ko landing the new history curriculum. Ko wai tēnei ko Leah Waipuka Bane ahau, ko te oriori tērā, ko te mō te wairarapa, risi tonu ki ahau. Ngai tara, ngāti ira, rangitāne, kahununi ki wairarapa, oku iwi, ngai tumapahi a rangi te hapū. Nō reira, e te whānau, I ngā tangata whakahirahira I kuhu mai roto I tēnei hoi, nau mai, nau mai, haere mai. I ngā tīpuna kua wehi te pō, haere, haere, haere. Kia ora, I'm Leah Waipuka Bane and bringing, landing the New Zealand new history curriculum to you this morning. And we have a lot of interesting kōrero, and I'm very, very excited to be presenting this and facilitating discussion as your chair. Kia ora, Heather came in the chat, and while we're there, introduce yourselves in the chat, where are you from, and feel free to keep the conversation going in the chat. And also we have questions, we're welcoming all the questions in this important kaupapa. So we're going to get right to it. We've got some housekeeping. So just with these kind of kōrero, we acknowledge that it can be quite emotionally challenging, and a lot of the kōrero is edgy because this is tiriti based futures. So our community code is, we are curious, we are open, respectful, we make generous assumptions, we're confidential, one person, one mic, we speak from our own experiences, no one knows everything, together we know a lot, make space, take space, we can't be articulate all the time, and we don't take ourselves too seriously. We've got some accessibility info, we've got live captions available, and you can go to www.caseviewnet.com, and those are all the session codes, and you enter your password and then click connect. So that's for our tangata whai kaha, we're looking after our disability people as well. Nō reira, the most important part, our first speaker for today is Dr. Liana MacDonald. It's my pleasure to open the floor for her. She is Ngāti Kuia, Rangitāne o Wairau, Ngāti Apa ki te Rātoa, Ngāti Kuata. Dr. Liana MacDonald is an Indigenous sociologist, Māori educationalist, and interdisciplinary researcher. She is especially interested in how teaching about the past in the view of a racialized society can contribute to transformative learning experiences. She has published several articles on this topic, and how settler colonial whiteness and racism are reproduced in public places and institutions. Dr. Liana has been involved in research projects exploring how Māori and Pākehā remember and forget difficult histories. She is currently researching diverse iwi and Pākehā perspectives of the Battle of Bullcott's Farm to change public perceptions of local history in Te Awa Kairangi, Ki Tai, Lower Hutt. It's my absolute pleasure to hand the floor to you, Dr. Liana. Kia ora.
Kia ora, Leah. Oh, that was a bit of a mouthful. Thank you. Tēnā tātou katoa. Nau mai, haere mai, ki tēnei hui. Ko Liana MacDonald, taku ingoa. He uri ahau no te waipaunamu. Ko Ngāti Kuia, rangitāne o Wairau, me Ngāti Apa ki te Rātoa oku iwi. Tēnā koutou katoa. So kia ora, I'm Liana, and I first want to echo Leah by saying a big mihi to the organisers of this auspicious event, to Richard and Vincent, and to all of us, to all of you who are joining us today. I'm really grateful to be part of this lineup, and I hope I can provide something of interest. Second, I want to acknowledge that my connection to this kaupapa, landing the new history curriculum, has in part come about through my involvement in Vincent and Joanna Kidman's research project about remembering and forgetting difficult histories in Aotearoa. In that project, I worked as a postdoctoral researcher between 2019 and 2020, where I learned about the New Zealand Wars, because I didn't learn about them at school or in my Bachelor of Arts majoring in history. And so I visited sites associated with the wars to see how those conflicts are remembered today. I also want to acknowledge my cousin Pete Mehana and the work that we've done and he continues to do teaching iwi history with local Marlborough colleges and to the wider community. So I've been really, really lucky to observe wonderfully skilled museum educators and iwi historians talk to secondary school students about the wars and other aspects of local history. And through those projects and beyond, I've always thought about how teaching and learning through the Aotearoa New Zealand Histories curriculum is an opportunity to connect with what has happened in the past to what is happening today, and to progress more authentic and equitable race relations through that. And while I know I'm not alone in this endeavour, and the curriculum's big ideas appear to be geared towards this outcome, and just to recap, those big ideas are how colonisation and settlement is central to history, that the course of histories has been shaped by power and relationships and connections between people, and that Māori history is the foundational and continuous history of Aotearoa. I don't think other aspects of the curriculum document or the lack of resourcing from the Ministry of Education has been particularly helpful in this regard. And so in the past few years, I've been thinking about how the Aotearoa New Zealand Histories curriculum and its proximity to the refreshed social sciences curriculum can be stretched or played with to enable students and teachers to connect book work and reading about the past to how we encounter historical narratives as a lived and embodied phenomenon. And I don't think the curriculum really engages with the importance of the latter, which is why I'm drawn to land education, because I think it offers a more practical and experiential approach to how our relationship to history informs how we operate in society today. So iwi historians and Māori communities have much to offer in this regard, and I know that Richard will talk more about this aspect later. So I thought I'd share some recent work that I've done with my university students, many of whom have just come from secondary school, so they're aged between about 18 and 21. I talked to you a bit about this idea of settler storytelling to briefly demonstrate this connection between the mind and the body that I'm driving towards. So what is it? Well, settler storytelling is a socially constructed, experiential and practical text that permeates our lives and relays subliminal messages about how past events and histories impact us today. And these messages kind of emanate insidiously from public sites and institutions where questions of national identity, colonial history and collective memory come into play. And these messages are reproduced among humans and through human and non-human interactions. So we both shape and are shaped by our environments. And settler storytelling benefits the dominant race in at least two ways. First, it cultivates this effective sense of belonging to the whenua that is benign and centred on unproblematic and historically resolved race relations. Second, settler storytelling keeps society moving in ways that will pay the most dividends to the dominant race. And so by curating silence and distance between the past and the present, New Zealanders may imagine that health and education, suicide, incarceration and housing disparities between Māori and non-Māori are not attributed to historical violence and ongoing colonial bias. And so last year, my sociology students were set a group assignment to choose a public place or institution as the focus of a small and immersive ethnographic study to explore how settler storytelling haunts their chosen site. And during the 5 weeks leading up to the site visits, the students learned about settler colonialism, about race and power, and associated concepts, and they practiced taking ethnographic field notes and looked at examples of fieldwork. They were given guidance around the fieldwork process, and they were required to research the history of their chosen site and learn how it had been used by people over time. So across two classes, six Wellington sites proved popular. They were Pukeahu National War Memorial Park, Cuba Street, the old government buildings, which doubles as the Victoria University Faculty of Law, Te Aro Park, and the Wellington train station. And so I thought I'd show you three slides from some of the students' work about Cuba Street in closing for this presentation. So the first one that's up at the moment, I think is currently displayed on your screen, was the most popular site that the students wanted to investigate, which is Cuba Street. And so each group presentation began with an historical account, starting with the insight that the street was named after the arrival of one of the first New Zealand company settler ships at Petone Wharf in Wellington Harbour in 1840, called the Cuba, or the boat was called the Cuba. The boat carried passengers and New Zealand company pioneers who were tasked with surveying land for incoming settlers. Further research about the area taught students that Cuba Street is based next to lands that were once Te Aro Pā. Te Aro Pā ran adjacent and across Cuba Street and was a big garden for the Te Atiawa people who lived there. Students learned that Te Atiawa migrated from Taranaki to Te Whanganui a Tara in the 1820s, yet one group noted that the New Zealand company laid out a town plan that disregarded the several existing pā in the area. So indications of a more sinister side to the area seem to be at odds with the signage describing Cuba Street down the street. A student noticed that the idea that Cuba Street is inclusive, multicultural, diverse, and home to a range of eclectic people is reinforced on information panels up and down the site. I'll change, Anna. Thanks. So once students learned more about the history of Cuba Street, they were bemused and critical of the way that important historical information was altered or obscured through how the environment had been constructed. Each group noticed how the country Cuba was celebrated on shop fronts and inside cafes. For example, students thought that the symbols and the cheers of the Midnight Espresso Cafe were connected to the country Cuba. And the photo on the right is of a shop lintel, which is quite clearly Che Guevara, former leader of the Cuban Revolution. And one student mapped Cuba's Street's offshore legacy to the early 2000s, where businesses like Fidel's, Cubita, Buena Vista Social Club, and Havana Copy Works capitalized on the Cuba name. Change, Anna, please. Research about the history of the area also revealed that the Tonks were one of the first families to settle in Cuba Street in 1842. The Tonks brought many properties and established successful brickyards, while Cuba Street evolved from a residential to retail focused site by the late 1860s. So several groups mentioned that the online information about Cuba Street was very one-sided. One student said that, well, the first three websites that pop up about Cuba Street, the Wellington City Council, Wikipedia, and theculturetrip.com all discuss the European settlers' great influence on the history and development of Cuba Street. While another student noted that when they Googled Cuba Street history, they mainly got results about heritage and colonial buildings. Students questioned why the Tonks family were openly acknowledged down Cuba Street, yet there was no reference to Te Atiawa and earlier settlements by Ngāi Tara, Ngāti Rangi, Ngāti Ira, Ngāti Mutunga, and Ngāti Tama, and others. And they felt like Cuba Street was celebrating a settler legacy. So these slides have been taken from a talk that I gave at the New Zealand History Association conference in November last year. And I'm gonna repeat the talk at the National Library next month. If you're keen to see it, it'll be live streamed. and so yeah, that's just a snapshot of some of the work that I've done with my students towards understanding this notion of settler storytelling and how an embodied narrative of New Zealand race relations is constructed at public sites in Wellington. Ka mutu, the end.
Hāpai. Who knew that about Cuba? Even I didn't know about that. That's amazing. Thank you, Dr. Liana. Amazing kōrero. You heard it here. It's going to be presented next week again. Maybe we'll get the link and send that out. So ka pai. Moving on to our next speaker. Thank you, Dr. Liana. Really appreciate that and your kōrero and your time. Next up, and I'm trying not to fangirl here, but this is Dr. Vincent O'Malley, is a Wellington writer and historian who has authored many best-selling works on Aotearoa history, including the Great War of New Zealand, Waikato 1800 to 2000, and the New Zealand Wars, Ngā Pakanga or Aotearoa. In 2022, his book, Voices from the New Zealand Wars, He Reo no Ngā Pakanga o Aotearoa, won the General Nonfiction Prize at the Oakham New Zealand Book Awards. In the same year, he received Prime Minister's Award for Literary Achievement in Nonfiction. He is a founding partner of History Works, a group of historians specialising in te tiriti or Waitangi-related research. With Professor Joanna Kidman, he is co-principal investigator of the Marsden Fund Project, He Taonga Te Wareware, Remembering and Forgetting Difficult Histories in Aotearoa New Zealand, a multi-year study into how the 19th century New Zealand wars have helped shape memory, identity and history. E te rangatira a ka hoatu te rākau ki a koe, tēnā koe.
Kia ora, tēnei te mihi ki a koutou, ko Vincent O'Malley toko ingoa, he kaimahi he tori au, no Airangi, ko te rangi me ngā rahi oku tipuna. So in my own 10 minutes or so, I thought I'd just talk about why it's important to learn our history. The consequences of so many of us not having done so, as we've heard, and how it can be a positive and empowering thing to engage with that past. Now, I've talked previously about my own experience of not learning New Zealand history at school. In a nutshell, we did European history. That was basically the English Civil War. I've said previously we're a land of tutor and steward experts because that's mainly what we learned about at school. And I asked my teacher one day, I said, "Sir, why aren't we learning any New Zealand history?" And he said, "Forget it, lad. It's boring. Nothing happened here. Move on." And so that was that. And it was only my exposure to New Zealand history was really accidental at university. And once I had that initial exposure to it, I thought, well, this is not boring. That couldn't be further from the truth. Why didn't I learn this stuff at school? And I think that's an experience that a lot of people have when they first gain that exposure to the history of this country. The notion that nothing happened here couldn't be further from the truth. And the thing is, my experience is hardly unique. I did a little experiment about 5 or 6 years ago on Twitter before it turned to shit about, I did a poll. And I asked people, I said, did you learn anything about New Zealand wars at school? Because it's just interesting, there seemed to be no data on this. And they had an amazing response, where about 1,500 people replied, and 2/3 of them said they learned nothing at all about New Zealand wars at school, which to me is an indictment, really, on our education system, that we didn't learn about these defining conflicts in our history. Of the 1/3 who said they had learned something about it, some people had really incredible learning experiences, and they often mentioned quite inspirational teachers who went out of their way to engage with them and often to take them to the sites where this history happened in the area. And that, I think, is an incredibly important part of the whole learning process, to visit these places. And others who did learn about them, some of them said that they didn't learn very much, or they got the kind of rose-tinted version of that history, which was, quite prevalent up until at least the 1970s anyway. So more broadly, there's overwhelming evidence that large numbers of New Zealand students leave school with little if any real exposure to New Zealand history. And they've done so for decades, for generations really, we've been denied that history. So what are the consequences of this intergenerational cycle of ignorance, of collective historical amnesia? Well, for one thing, you get politicians who prey on this lack of knowledge to completely misrepresent Te Tiriti o Waitangi. ACT couldn't get away with that in an historically aware and engaged Aotearoa. So knowledge is powerful. We need to, if we have that historical understanding and context, we can see through a lot of the crap that, that people try and put across to us. But I think there's more to it than that as well. And this sort of brings me back to the often quoted line from Alan Kernow, "Not I, some child born in a marvellous year will learn the trick of standing upright here." And I think for me, a big part of that trick is reconciling ourselves with the history of this country. And that's not the imagined history of a plucky wee nation at the bottom of the globe punching against its way to egalitarian and forward-looking. You know, I'm talking about the uglier, the more confrontational past that, that Pākehā have turned away from for so long. You know, John Key's insistence in 2014 that New Zealand was colonised peacefully was widely ridiculed at the time, but I think a lot of people shared that view because they didn't know the contrary. They hadn't actually learned any New Zealand history. So they had this kind of rose-tinted view of our past where nothing terrible really ever happened. But hey, first country in the world where women gained the vote, weren't we wonderful? So it was kind of a self-congratulatory, kind of smug view of our history. And what I've always said is that a mature nation takes ownership of its history. It doesn't just cherry pick out the bits it'd like to remember, like, you know, the suffragettes. But it also acknowledges the bad stuff as well. And I think moving confidently into the future, we have to have a robust understanding of where we've come from. That's really important. So reconciling ourselves to the history of this land is not just about supporting the settlement of historical Treaty of Waitangi claims. That's part of the story, but it's not the whole solution. It's also about ordinary New Zealanders learning this history, acknowledging it, taking ownership of it, making sure their children and their grandchildren learn these stories too, so they can be big enough to say, this is part of our story, this is who we are as a nation, as a society. The Waitangi Tribunal wrote in one of its reports that while only one side remembers the suffering of the past, dialogue will always be difficult. One side commences a dialogue with anger and the other side has no idea why. And they say reconciliation cannot be achieved by this means. And I think that's a powerful statement. So, you know, in order to achieve that reconciliation, we need to start from a base of historical awareness. We need to understand what happened. And historical awareness also brings a lot of other benefits, allowing people to better understand the world and the landscape all around them. And for example, they might learn that there's a history, there's a backstory to disproportionately high levels of Māori poverty today that just didn't appear from nowhere. They might also learn that that wasn't always the case, that in the 1840s and 1850s, Māori were the leading drivers of the New Zealand economy, before that's destroyed in the 1860s through the New Zealand Wars, the NF Land Court, and so on. So there's a darker national narrative that to one many have preferred to imagine. And a lot of New Zealanders probably pass sites of immense historical significance every day, and they don't even realise that they're there. And often they don't just pass by them, they drive through the middle of them. Ōrākau Pā, Waikato is a good example. The road was constructed through the middle of the pā. So it's not just forgetting that history, it's almost like obliterating any last physical remnants of it as if it was never there in the first place. And that, you know, that's just what, there are multiple examples of that all around the country. The thing is, we know from the Otorohanga College petition in 2015 that led to a National Day of Commemoration for New Zealand Wars, that young people want to engage with this history because they didn't just call for the National Day of Commemoration, they also asked that this history be taught in all schools. And they wanted that history taught in an upfront and honest way. So the announcement in 2019 that New Zealand history would be taught in all schools from last year, I think was a really crucial step in ensuring future generations leave school with at least some basic understanding of our nation's past, including the good, the bad, and the ugly, as Rahui Papa put it. But it also opens up, I think, important conversations around that, how that should take place. And for me, it's really important that iwi and hapu are at the forefront of those conversations. Connecting with mana whenua histories, I think, is a really powerful thing for rangatahi to engage with, to learn about the whenua that they live on, the place where their school is, and Richard will talk about this soon. So children need to have that place-based understanding of their local context, but they also need to be able to place that in a wider national context as well. So it's about putting those pieces together. And in terms of how these different topics are taught, I think it's less a case of filling young minds with endless lists of dates and places and other facts, but rather equipping them with the critical thinking skills to understand how broad historical processes played out in Aotearoa, how those played out in their community. I think knowing when a particular event took place is ultimately less important than understanding why they still matter today. I think that's a really important part. So analysing and critiquing historical sources is obviously an important part of that. And I think a lot of dedicated and inspiring teachers are already leading the way with this, and they have been for years. So the previous curriculum was one where schools could choose to do this, and some did, and they did an amazing job. The problem was all those schools where it wasn't being taught because it wasn't a requirement. It was a lottery system. You know, if your children were lucky enough, they might learn some New Zealand history, otherwise forget about it. It was back to the Tudors and the Stuarts for them. And I think it's precisely because historical knowledge is a powerful thing that some politicians want to dismantle the new curriculum in schools and instead engage in fairy tales about our past, the kind of rose-tinted version of that. And I think, you know, as I said, we need to be upfront and honest about what happened here. And we can't, you know, that this curriculum, I think in the long term, may be one of the most transformative things that the last government did, because future generations will grow up with an awareness of, you know, the places they live in, the place where they went to school, and they have that historical grounding. And I think that's really important. And it's too important to allow politicians to take away from this. So that's me. Thank you.
Tēnā koe, te rangatira, such important insights and very important kaupapa in terms of, you know, standing for that hard conversation, getting our history curriculums into schools. I know I learned the Russian Revolution. Our history is much more interesting, can I say? and also quite hard as well. I have been a teacher for quite a long time in my previous life, and it's always transformative to see particularly Māori students walk their land and know who they are and acknowledge on that part, you know, the missing piece really. So just a big, big mihi to you, Dr. Vincent, and we really appreciate you and all your work. Kia ora.
Kia ora, thank you.
All right. We're getting through our kōrero quite fast today. Don't forget to put in your questions. We're going to open up the floor at the end of all of our presentations, just a quick fireside chat. So make sure you're putting those questions in the Q&A, and we'll open the floor at the end of our presentations. Moving on. To the implementation side of how do you actually do this thing, and what are the good examples. So introducing Richard James Crawford, he uri ia no Ngāti Kahununu, Ngāti Parau me Ngāti Raukawa hoki. He was born in Hastings and raised at Bridge Power. His father is from Te Araroa, and his grandfather is from on his mother's side was born in Parau, Waira. He commenced his current principal position at Fairfield College in Kirikiriroa in 2012, previously principal of Forest View High School in Tokoroa from 2007 to 2011. Since 2018, he has been the lead principal of Te Paihere, Te Raki Rāwhiti or Kirikiriroa Kāhui Ako, strengthening relationships with mana whenua Ngāti Wairere. Continues to be a key leadership focus of the schools and early child education services. The ongoing collaborative design of www.ngapuna.org, which will be put in the chat for you guys to have a look at, it's amazing, acknowledges the critical role of the narratives of mana whenua in the design and delivery of local curriculums, and is an expression of the strengthening relationship between Kāhui Ako and Ngāti Wairere. He was also privileged to be a member of the design team led by Tōkuna Te Rahi to design and publish Kōkiri Hia. This is a resource to assist schools to end the discriminatory practice of streaming in Aotearoa. It's my absolute pleasure to introduce Richard today. Ka hoa tu te rā kai ki a koe e te rangatira.
Oh, tēnā koe, Leah. Thank you, Leah. Thank you, Liana. Thank you, Vincent. And thank you, Ngāti Wairere, for approving my participation in this presentation. Ngāti Wairere are the mana whenua of the 23 schools and 14 early learning centres that are members of the Kahui Ako Te Pai Heri Taraki Rāwhiti or Heri Kiriroa that Leah spoke about, which I have the privilege of being the lead principal of. We are situated in the northeast area of Kirikiriroa, Hamilton. So in my kōrero today, I'll share key aspects of Te Pai Heri's continuing partnership strengthening journey with Ngāti Wairere and link this to the ongoing landing of the Aotearoa New Zealand Histories Curriculum into Pai Heri Kura schools and early learning centres. I will share key learnings, a caution, and a hope that Te Pai Heri has for the future of the Ngāti Wairere, Te Pai Heri partnership, which we believe is seminal in the effective landing of the Aotearoa New Zealand Histories Curriculum in our schools and our early learning centres. The we that I refer to are the principals and centre directors of Te Pai Heri schools and early learning centres. The development of a genuine, mutually beneficial partnership with Ngāti Wairere is one of our early and foundational learnings. We learned and are continuing to learn that accessing their voices, their narratives, their lived experiences, their recollections, their waiata, their karakia, their māmai, or their hurt, their hopes and aspirations for theirs and our futures added the essential local perspectives to what we were seeking to develop in our Aotearoa New Zealand Histories curriculums. Without their tautoko support, we learned that we would struggle to develop what retired Professor Wally Penotito refers to as place-based learning and the Ministry of Education refers to as a local curriculum. Now, this continues to be a key Te Pai Heri priority. This learning acknowledges that Aotearoa New Zealand Histories curriculum needs to be personalised to the place that a school or ELC is located. For our situation, many of the voices and experiences of our mana whenua could not be accessed from books, and we were uncertain of the authenticity of much that was accessible on the internet. This led to another key learning. What our mana whenua chose to share with us as essentially a koha was a direct reflection of their trust in the development of the partnership between us and them. Why, what, and how they are choosing to share with us is an example of this trust. And Ngāti Wairere Kaumātua Karahau Te Amo explains an aspect of their why at a Te Pai Heri Deputy Principal and Assistant Principal Conference in October 2020, and I quote, "Te Pai Heri was a pretty good waka to latch on to moving forward as an iwi with our hopes and aspirations into the future for ourselves, for our children, for our tamariki, for our grandchildren. Therein was one of the main reasons that we connected with Te Pai Heri," end quote. The what that we agreed to was the development of a website that would be accessible to the public. I return back to the 2020 conference, and in reference to this website, quote again, Karahau Te Amo, who said this, and I quote, "What is going to be the benefit for us? One of the benefits that some of us could see is that stories or narratives of tangata whenua, mana whenua, hapū, iwi, whānau that are coming out in such a fashion that some of them can be misinterpreted or some of them can be mismanaged. In other words, if you are going to get a story from Ngāti Wairere from here on out, you are only going to get it from one source, and that's the source that we will create for the so-called resource that's being created," end quote. The so-called resource that Karahau Te Amo refers to is the website ngapuna.org. The website was formally approved by Ngāti Wairere through a signing of a memorandum of understanding at the Hukunui Marae and the Wharenui Te Tuturoa Papa Kāmutu on May the 27th, 2021. The memorandum of understanding was signed by Kuia Heke Tirangi Broadhurst and Kaumātua George Hopper. The lived experiences of both of these people feature on the website, as does the lived experiences of Dr. Ngā Pare Hopper and soon to be added Silla Henry, Fire Silla Henry, and other Kaumātua that we are busily interviewing and trying to get their perspectives. The raupatu, or land confiscations, the naming of Wairere himself and the links to the Waikato River, the kiingitanga, their interactions with Te Puia Herangi as children, the importance of the pokai, their home lives as children, are some of the kaupapa they speak to. He taonga paunamu tuku iho tēnei. Indeed, gifts given to us from our elders. So ngāpuna.org was released at the inaugural Te Paihere Professional Learning Day on the June the 4th, 2021. To bring over 700 teachers together to wānanga and learn about important kaupapa is something that we value immensely. In fact, Vincent co-delivered a plenary with Professor Joanna Kidman and Associate Professor Tom Roa at this inaugural Professional Learning Day, and they spoke about the invasion of the Waikato and other aspects of the conflicts that we often refer to as the New Zealand Wars, and why it is so important that these conflicts be taught in schools. Importantly for us, our mana whenua led this professional learning day. They have also led the 22 and 2023 Te Paihere Professional Learning Days, and similarly, they will lead the scheduled May the 31st, 2024 Te Paihere Professional Learning Day. The how that I believe Ngāti Wairere agreed to was their sharing of their taonga with us, their koha to us. And as referenced earlier, what has been shared and what will be shared in the future is an expression of their trust in the relationship that we are continuously seeking to strengthen. Another learning, and also, yeah, a caution for others that are considering traversing a similar pathway with their mana whenua, is to realise at the outset that the goals, their goals, and their priorities of their schools or their kahuyako may not be the same goals and priorities of their mana whenua. Be patient. Know that in most situations, your mana whenua are operating as unpaid volunteers who were there long before the school or kahuyako's current strategic and annual plan was activated, and will be there long after it has been replaced by the next cycle of planning. Do not mistake what you may perceive as their non-compliance to the time schedules of the objectives of your strategic plan as disinterest in these objectives, but instead continue to invest in the partnership until there is an alignment of goals and priorities. Often this alignment will coincide with the availability of mana whenua personnel to work on the goals and the priorities. A hope that we have for the future of the Ngāti Wairere Te Paihere partnership is that it is free from political persuasion, and that we collectively find a pathway that enables Te Paihere to employ Ngāti Wairere representatives to work with us as cultural and place-based learning advisors, so that we can sustainably and continuously include what we consider to be non-negotiable mana whenua voices in the design and teaching of our Aotearoa New Zealand Histories curriculums. The process has commenced, and we are excited about the opportunity that this presents to gain further traction in achieving the shared goals and priorities of Ngāti Wairere and Te Paihere. So being free from political persuasion means that the nature of our relationship and the inclusion of their taonga in our Aotearoa New Zealand Histories curriculum is not dependent on the government of the day. I've spoken about the Ngāti Wairere Te Paihere experience, but there are numerous other exciting mana whenua kahuyako stories unfolding in our country. Liana spoke about her cousin and what's happening in Marlborough. But here in Hamilton, I can speak about the Ngāti Mahanga and the Hewaki Eke Nua Kahuyako, or the Ngāti Hawa and the Hillcrest Kahuyako. Now, there's just two examples of kahuyako seeking mana whenua presence in the design and teaching of their Aotearoa New Zealand History curriculums. It is both exciting and revitalising, and shows promise and hope that an Aotearoa New Zealand History's curriculum that genuinely features the voices of mana whenua will enable the Aotearoa New Zealand citizens of both our present and our futures to possess a more informed historical knowledge of the interactions that have shaped their and our regions and their and our country. An Aotearoa New Zealand History's curriculum that includes the colour of their voices, the voices I'm talking about, our mana whenua, their lived experience, that is, you know, what we're striving to do at Te Paihere, and like I said earlier, other kahuyako throughout New Zealand. So, you know, he hoia kai manawa e nei taonga. Nō reira, ka nui te mihi ki tō mātou mana whenua a Ngāti Wairere. You know, these are treasured gifts that they're sharing with us. It is based on our relationship. I want to acknowledge our mana whenua, Ngāti Wairere, for their koha, for their aroha to us. Ka mihi rau atu hoki ki ngā mana whenua o Iarohe o te whenua nei. But I also acknowledge and mihi other mana whenua throughout the country, because I know, that there's some great work going on. Nō reire e te whānau, ka mutu taku kōrero ki a koutou. Tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, ki ora rawa ki a koutou.
Tēnā koe, te ihi, te wehi, te mana o i roto e tō kōrero e pāna ki Ngāti Wairere me tō mahi i roto i tērā kāhui. Ako tēnā koe e te rangatira, te principal rā. Nō reira. Thank you for the amazing kōrero, and also giving an example of how this might look and how this is done well, and also acknowledging that the mana whenua and the people of the land, they give these gifts, and that's not to be taken lightly. Hāpai. So we have a bit of time. I seem to have, we've gone through that quite quickly actually, so we've got a bit of time to answer the questions and answers in the that have been sent through in the Q&A. So what I might do is just start answering the questions and then sort of open it up to any of our lovely kaikōrero that might like to answer them. So we'll start off with, there's one for Dr. MacDonald. Dr. MacDonald's course is an excellent example of what can happen in a class. My question is whether these findings by the students were shared with the community members.
Ah, cool. Yes. Okay. It's a good question. I think firstly, I'd just like to approach that question by saying that the stuff that I presented, I would imagine sort of, one of the problems or issues with the histories curriculum is that it's couched with the social science, social studies curriculum. So the two are together, and that's a bit problematic. And I think that we need to be careful that the stuff that we do around settler storytelling doesn't take over from the really rich stuff that Richard and the Rōpū that he works with are doing. So I think, you know, in terms of thinking about how something similar might happen in a class, it could be a nice way of marrying the histories and social studies curriculum together, but keeping the histories curriculum preserved for that space where Māori is the continuous and foundational history of Aotearoa, if that makes sense. So I'm always a bit cautious about, you know, whiteness, centering whiteness and taking over spaces that should be for Māori. The second part of the question, the work that I did with students was for a sociology course. So it was part of their assessment for that course. So it hasn't really gone out any more widely than what I've talked to you today about and what I've done in that histories, with that histories conference last year, and will do with the National Library coming up. So yeah, it hasn't been shared any more widely than that.
We have another one here. Do any of the kaikōrero expect to hear from the coalition government about the review taking place of our histories curriculum? Are they part of the review?
Well, I think I did hear that the Education Minister Erica Stanford had said that it wasn't a priority for her at the moment. So whether that means it's on the back burner, I don't know, but I mean, I'd be interested in Richard's view in terms of how that might actually affect what's happening on the ground, because it seems to me that the relationship that he has established with Ngāti Wairere will endure regardless of what governments do. And I think with that curriculum in place, it's, you know, what happens at a local level is not necessarily going to be the same as what a government may want to happen. But I mean, in terms of this kind of view of rebalancing the curriculum, I mean, what does that mean? We go back to teaching the rose-tinted version on which New Zealand had the greatest race relations in the world? Do we want generations of school children growing up learning lies about our past? That's not a mature way to engage with our history. And And, you know, I can't see that schools having gone down this road to open up to be more truthful and upfront and honest about the history are going to want to go down that path personally. But I'd be interested in Richard's views on that as well.
Yeah, I'm happy to kōrero to that. So it's just this whole call that the government and the coalition government, mainly through the ACT Party, I believe, but is this whole idea about rebalancing. You know what that's saying, that once upon a time the curriculum was actually balanced, but it never has been. So it's really interesting that they're asking for that. So for me, as sort of like for us who have invested in, and can I say this, it's just, like I said, just to emphasise, there are lots of schools all through the motu who are doing what Te Paihere is doing. And so for me, you know, if that call, so whatever it is in terms of their balancing, what they're talking about, and I often speak to this to principals, even sort of last year I was speaking to them, that there comes a time that we need to show moral and ethical leadership as principals. And so what that is about is really whatever their balancing looks like, what it can't look like is seeking to diminish the voices of the mana whenua in the teaching of the curriculum. So if that is going to happen in any way, shape or form, you know, you can expect some resistance from professionals, from our groups to whatever that looks like. At the moment, we don't know what it looks like, but what I can say is, you know, we've come too far. And we have come, you know, like I've been teaching for like, well, how long have I been teaching now? 35 years, I've been 19 years as a principal. And I think you mentioned it yourself, Vincent, about the transformative move that the government made. So what I'm saying is we've come too far to even slide back a little bit. And so we, if that is the call, or if that is the call, and I hope that's not, you know, there will be some interesting kickback from a lot of professionals, including myself as a principal, but I'd like to thank my colleagues that are in Te Paihere because of, you know, the investment and the trust. We keep on talking about trustful relationships and sustainable relationships with our mana whenua. But that's all I have to say about that. Kia ora.
Hāpai, mō tērā whakautu mōs te pātai. We've got quite a long one here from Thomas Slade. The term historical amnesia is used a lot in reference to Pākehā's failure to remember the more difficult parts of our history. Do you think amnesia is a bit too comfortable of a term to use and fits with the comfortable narrative Pākehā used to justify their connection to history? Do you think we should be more honest and direct with Pākehā failure to remember and look at terms like historical ignorance and terms that take ownership of this failure?
I'll jump in there and start off. I think that the term historical amnesia is great and it carries a lot of currency. I think back to when it was first sort of used more in the public sphere, and I sort of attribute that a bit to you, Vincent. I don't know if you feel that way, but, and I think for the time it was important, like it sort of got out an idea that was probably quite foreign to many New Zealanders. And I think like anything to do with something that is introduced for the first time, you know, this histories curriculum, we're just starting out as our understanding of how to teach history in more equitable, inclusive ways evolves, you know, so will the language and our understanding of, you know, what we would attribute historical amnesia to. And yeah, definitely stronger language needs to come in that's more descriptive, you know, shows we're more knowledgeable about mechanisms that, societal mechanisms that are contributing to historical amnesia. You know, yes, ignorance, constructed ignorance, yes, I think we need to grow and develop stronger terms, terms that, you know, show how complex, I guess, this situation is and demonstrate a variety of ways of how we need to engage with teaching the histories curriculum.
Yeah, I think the question is really about the agency that is involved in that amnesia. So I'm not suggesting that there isn't a willful element to that. And likewise, you know, when Liana and I talk about remembering and forgetting, people often assume that's like, whoops, I didn't remember that. But forgetting can be willful and deliberate as well. It's like, you know that there's this terrible stuff that you don't want to engage with and remember, so you suppress it. It's still there. And so that's, you know, memory scholars use the term forgetting not to imply something that has simply slipped your mind, but often it's actively suppressed. And I think that that's also the way that I use the term historical amnesia. It can cover that deliberate suppression of our history as well.
Kia ora. Deliberate suppression. Another one, when discussing Aotearoa New Zealand History's curriculum, is te takanga o te wā and te marautanga o te Aotearoa for Māori medium included under that banner, or will it be discussed later? Anyone have any comments on that one? Let's just wait and see in development, perhaps.
Yeah, it'll be, I mean, it will be discussed, I'm sure, in terms of the review. But obviously the people that are going to be sitting around that table, someone's asked the earlier question in terms of the review, who's going to be sitting around the table? There's no doubt that there'll be, you know, certain people sit around the table when they discuss that. Again, depending upon what the coalition government, the angle that they push. I mean, one thing that I will say, but the chances is I do want to take my hat off to the curriculum designers and the people who've actually done the Aotearoa New Zealand Histories curriculum, because it was a tough ask. It was a big ask, you know, and they're open to criticism, which they have been. But for me, they've put something on the table, and it's, you know, it's up for us to work with it. No doubt there will be some changes. I mean, in terms of the takanga o te wā, obviously I'm not very familiar with that program, but I'm just suspecting that that will be done also. Ma whakaro noi ho tēnei ne, aroha mai.
Hāpai he pai te whakaro. We had one around the issues of burden and willingness of hapū to engage with schools and entrusting them with their knowledge and narratives. I wonder, Richard, how you bridge the gap in that and bringing them on board, because obviously this is quite an advanced one, and it's a real evidence of how this works, but it obviously took quite a while.
And it does. I mean, it takes a long time. It does. It's not something that happens overnight. And one of the things about kahui ako, if there's anything to me that's really a strong positive point about it, is that enables our mana whenua to actually, you know, just to be more effective across everybody who's asking for their time. Okay, and there are, and these are just the schools that are knocking on their door. So going back to the question, I can't, you know, really, it just takes time, it takes effort, it takes, like I said, it's a relationship that has to be built up over time. And like for us, like I said before, I remember having meetings with certain people, and I had all these schedules and I had all these dates, you know, what a waste of, you know, like I said, it's not about dates and it's not about schedules, it's about being around and being prepared to operate on not your timetable, but the timetable of the mana whenua. And as long as you can accept that and know that sometimes it's not going to happen overnight, and it can be a long process, you've just got to invest in that and be patient. That's all I can say about that, because that's what my experience has been.
Kia pai. I remember in my teaching career when the big stuff about tūhoe came out, and I sort of went to the social studies teacher and I said, oh, are we teaching this? Is this, you know, are we going to be talking about this? And the answer was, you can, because I'm feeling I'm feeling a few fears about this and how I'm going to do this. So the question is, an anonymous attendee, and the question is, what strategies would you suggest to encourage teachers who do not want to engage or have fears about teaching New Zealand histories?
I think one thing I'd say is that we should remember, or we should be mindful, that most teachers are themselves products of the education system that denied generations of New Zealanders knowledge of that history in the first place. So It's about breaking that cycle of ignorance, as I said in my talk. And I mean, in terms of how that's done, I mean, it really the professional learning development process is really important in that. And I think that's where mana whenua, if they're willing, need to be integral to that. And I've also said in the past that, you know, the Ministry of Education can't expect hapu to do that for a cup of tea and a biscuit at the end of the day. They need to be properly resourced to participate in that process. And I'm not aware whether that's happening at the moment, but that to me is a really key part of it, because, you know, not more broadly than education, so many burdens are placed on iwi around the country to do things for free. And they actually need to be resourced to participate in this process, because they're critical to its success.
And there are sites on Facebook where there are communities of history teachers who are trying to grapple, you know, with this and share resources. And there have been webinars, and there's been professional development initiatives that I've seen being rolled out through, you know, other colleagues. So I think there's stuff out there, you know, people need to push themselves to get out there too and access that material.
Yeah, what I was saying about the Te Paere offering, the kahui ako approach, you know, like for us, yes, we are a bigger kahui ako, but it just enables Ngāti Wairere to connect with, you know, 23 schools through this group, rather than trying to connect with each single school. So I think our experience about that, I really think it's a positive way moving forward. I'm not sure how it can be done any other way. In terms of not the capability of mana whenua, they're very capable, but the capacity. And yeah, like I said, there are some exciting things already happening around the motu in terms of kahui ako and, you know, difference how they connect with their mana whenua.
Hāpai, we've got four questions left in 4 minutes, so a punchy answer maybe for each one. Okay, so we've got, looking to the future, what opportunities do you see for further enhancing the implementation of Te Tiriti Waitangi principles within local and central government structures and decision-making processes? Probably not a one-minute answer, but does anyone want to offer anything on that one?
I guess for me, it's still, you know, at the end of the day, it's going to be politically driven. I mean, if you look at the Education Act right now, in terms of it requires schools to give effective Te Tiriti o Waitangi, it's a non-negotiable, it's an expectation that we do. So how that looks moving forward. So regardless how, again, I'm going to say, regardless of how that looks moving forward, I still think there's a commitment for us as professionals, as boards, to know that, you know, that's got to be central to what we're doing. But again, it's still dependent. I'm trying to say, regardless of what the government are going to say about that, we're still going to drive that through.
Hāpai. So along with that whakaaro, does the group, the lecturers, Kaikōrero, have any suggestions alongside civil protest? It's a bit of a hard one, right?
Well, maybe teaching history to your children is considered a subversive act now, so, you know, but maybe that's a part of it. Because, I mean, one of the things I'd love to see around, you know, with the histories curriculum is that the children teach their parents and grandparents who were denied this history themselves during their own school years. And there are lots of ways you could do that. You know, imagine having community nights where the students do presentations and their parents and grandparents come along and maybe learn about Aotearoa New Zealand history for the first time themselves. So I think there are lots of really cool things you can do around that, and lots of interesting exercises with the students to engage with the history of their community as well. You know, like, you know, an exercise might be for them to go and learn about the origins of the street names that they live on or the school is on. Just, you know, basic stuff like that. So that they become curious and they ask questions, because that's one of the things you learn from history, to be skeptical and to ask questions about things and to get that understanding of the broader context of things as well.
Hāpai, We've got 1 minute to go, so I might just leave it there, but that's a great practical suggestion, and I do that all the time with my son, take him to these places and it does work and it's amazing. So I just want to mihi to our kaikōrero, thank you for your time and effort and mātauranga that you've shared with us, and also to those online and the organisers. I think we have a slide that we were going to, yes, here we are. Nga mihi nui to our partners and our sponsors here that make Te Tiriti Based Futures anti-racism possible. All those great people. And just a big shout out, kei te muro te ahi marathon for racial justice is an epic 5-hour marathon, short bite-sized talks from our lightest and brightest graduates that are presenting their research. So that's amazing. That's on Friday the 22nd of March starting at 8:30. We welcome all of you to have a listen, and I will finish off with karakia. Whakataka te hau ki te uru, whakataka te hau ki te tonga, kia mā kine kine ki uta, kia mā taratara ki tai, e hi aki ana te ata kura, he tio, he hoka, he hauhu, tihei mauri ora.